What's up, Cedar Grove Christian Church? Pastor Rob here. I hope that you are having a fantastic week. It's Tuesday morning, and we're past that first day of the week. For many of you, you had an extended weekend, so perhaps maybe this is the day that you go back to work. I hope that you have a blessed day today as you do your work and as you strive to be an imitator of Jesus Christ for everyone around you. As we dive into our study today, we're going to be in Romans chapter 8, starting at verse 18. The Apostle Paul is going to deal with this thing of suffering. And if we're quite honest, suffering is not something that we find pleasant to talk about. It's something that we often struggle with. It's something in which we all experience a great deal of difficulty. But the simple truth of the matter is that you and I have a great encouragement through Jesus Christ, that we can endure and we can deal with the matters at hand. Remember that last week, as we concluded our section in on Friday, we talked about the fact that suffering is part of being a Christian. You and I will experience suffering of many kinds, and it is easy for us, if we do not walk with Christ, to become discouraged. However, we must remain fruitful, and we must continue to seek after Christ so that we may grow in our faith. Let's see what the Apostle Paul has to say in Romans chapter 8, starting at verse 18. I would invite you, if you have your Bible, go ahead and turn and follow along. If not, pause this video, go grab it, and come back so that we can be in the text together. Romans chapter 8, starting at verse 18. For I consider that the suffering of this present time are not worth comparing with the glory that is going to be revealed to us. For the creation eagerly awaits with anticipation for God's sons to be revealed. For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in the hope that the creation itself will also be set free from the bondage to decay into the glorious freedom of God's children. For we know that the whole creation has been groaning together with labor pains until now. Not only that, but we ourselves, who have the Spirit as the first fruits, we also groan within ourselves, eagerly awaiting for adoption, the redemption of our bodies. Now in this hope we were saved, but hope that is seen is not hope, because who hopes for what he sees? Now if we hope for what we do not see, we eagerly await for it with patience. In the same way, the Spirit also helps in our weakness, because we do not know what to pray for as we should. But the Spirit himself intercedes for us with inexpressible groanings, and he who searches our hearts knows the mind of the Spirit, because he intercedes for the saints according to the will of God. We know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purpose. For those he foreknew, he also predestined to be conformed to the image of his Son, so that he would be the firstborn among many brothers and sisters. And those he predestined, he also called. And those he called, he also justified. And those he justified, he also glorified. So as we dive into this text, there are a couple of points that I want to make to you this morning. The first one is that Paul is not surprised, nor does he hinder the possibility that you and I will experience many sufferings for our faith. In fact, if you notice, he says, I consider the sufferings of this present time not to be worth comparing to the future glory. And there reveals our first point, Paul's mindset. Paul's mindset is not on the things that are taking place currently. They're not on the things of the flesh. They're not on the pain and the suffering that he has to endure for his faith. No, his mindset, his focus, his goal are on things to come. His focus and his goal is on the resurrected body, on the hope that he has in Christ, on the hope of eternal life, not on the current sufferings that he is experiencing. And I think this is a very important point for us, church, because as we encounter suffering for the name of Christ, as we endure hardship and difficulty, adversity, we ourselves will be tempted to fall away. We ourselves will be tempted to give in to the pressure. But the simple truth is, when we do so, it is often because we do not have our mindset on the things that which we should. We are focused on the temporary. We are focused on the current. We are not looking forward towards heaven. And because of that, we falter and stumble. So Paul's first admonishment to us this morning is to consider what is yet to come, to keep our minds on the cross, to keep our focus on our hope, not to be bogged down by the current sufferings. Some of these sufferings come as a result of our faith. Others of these sufferings, Paul is going to reveal out in our second point of this passage. Some of our suffering is not because God has foreordained it or because God has directly caused it, or because of something that we have done, or because of something that we will do. Sometimes we suffer because all of creation was subjected to futility. I don't know if you caught that. In verse 19, Paul says, "For creation eagerly awaits in anticipation for God's sons to be revealed." For in verse 20, "For the creation was subjected to futility, not willingly, but because of him who subjected it, in the hope that the creation," verse 21, "itself will also be set free from the bondage to decay." Here's a simple truth. When Adam and Eve sinned, and sin entered into the world, along with sin, so did death, so did disease, so did all the disasters that we think of now that plagued our minds and hurt our spirits. All the suffering that is currently present in this world entered in because of sin. Sometimes the suffering that we experience is a direct result of our sin. Sometimes it's a divine sentence. Sometimes it's just from the fact that all of creation has been subjected to futility. All of creation has been subjected to decay and disease. And just like us, it eagerly awaits for its adoption. It eagerly awaits for its transformation, its revitalization in fire. But it awaits for the judgment, just as we should be eagerly awaiting for the judgment. Point number one, we will have sufferings and we need to keep our focus on our hope in Christ. Number two, the sufferings are not always a result of our sin, but rather a result of the fallen state of this world. Number three, and this is perhaps a big one that we often will struggle with, we ourselves must keep our hope. We must keep our hope. We must not give in. We must not back down. But we must continue to live a life that is in hope. And yes, hope is a funny thing, because hope is not something that you do for something that you can see. Hope is for something you can't see. And that makes it very difficult. It makes it very difficult. And it is impossible for us to keep hope if we don't first realize that we have to keep our focus on Christ. And also if we don't realize that sometimes the suffering that we experience is not a result of something that we did, not something that God is punishing us for, but rather it is a result of the fact that all of creation was subjected to futility. We have to maintain our hope. And point number four, we don't have to do it alone. This is perhaps, I think, the most difficult area Christians walk in and struggle with. You and I do not have to try to follow hope, to seek after hope, to seek after Christ. We don't have to try to do that by ourselves. The fact is that in many of the most difficult situations in our life, we don't even know how to formulate a prayer. We don't know what we should pray for or how we should pray, and we trip over our words and we fumble over our sentences. And maybe it's because we've lost hope. Maybe that's the reason why we struggle with it. But the beautiful thing is that you and I have an intercessor in the Holy Spirit who intercedes for us. He understands our thoughts. He understands our difficulties. He understands our struggles. He understands the pain in which we are suffering. And he intercedes for us in a language that we cannot comprehend. But Christ knows. The Father knows. And because of that, they respond. One of the things that I think is crucial for us to understand is we have a very limited view. In the eternal grand scheme of things, you and I are finite creatures with a very limited view. If you will, we can't see past our own noses. And so we can't see how God is working things out in the midst of our suffering and our difficulty and our adversity. We can't see how God's working things out. But if you take nothing out of this morning's devotional video, teaching video, I encourage you to take this to heart. Romans chapter 8, verse 8. "We know that all things work together for the good of those who love God, who are called according to his purposes." That is a promise, church. God is working everything for your good. But hear me on this. You may not see that good on this side of eternity. Keep your focus on Christ. Don't lose your hope. God's got this. That's all I have for you this morning. God bless. We'll see you back here on Friday.